Right, and now over here, I did promise you some fantastic mammals, and we have a couple of very fantastic mammals in the form of Terry and your daughter, Sally. Welcome, thanks very much, and you've brought with you some equally fantastic mammals, and this is, who's this?
This is Poppy.
This is Poppy, and now we've got a hound, and we have a fox, and this is Artie the fox, and you are lovely. Now, we've had a lot of foxes on Autumn Watch, and we've Chris has been following the fortunes of the urban and suburban foxes in Brighton. Now, whether you like foxes or not, I just want you to put the fox politics out of your mind and just enjoy the fact that we have a fox in the studio. So my first question is, what's his story?
Well, about 3 years ago, he came to us as a very, very small cub, and he was covered in ticks, and we... in the process of taking off the ticks over a while, because there were all sorts of eggs on him and he wasn't in a very good way, he became imprinted, so obviously he couldn't go back into the wild again. Normally, when we rescue foxes, we put them back into the wild, not locally. We have great relationships with local farmers, so we don't put them back into farmland. We do put them usually into the wilds of Scotland, where there are no bother. But he couldn't go back, so he has a life now of educating children, really. We take him out to schools, and just think, having the opportunity of getting that close to a fox is just unbelievable.
Well, it's pretty cool for us as well. Mm-hmm. So the question I really want to ask is, what's the relationship between the dog and the fox here? Because this is quite an unusual sight, isn't it?
Well, originally, we had a Jack Russell, and the Jack Russell... kind of mothered the fox when the fox was a baby, but unfortunately the Jack Russell died.
Oh no.
So after that had happened, we had to then get a surrogate dog. So we got Poppy as a puppy, and it became the opposite relationship, really. And they love each other and they play with each other a lot. It's enrichment. We have tried other foxes in with Artie, but he doesn't think he's a fox. He thinks he's human, so he likes taking the dog for a walk now.
Brilliant. Well, it's really, really, really nice to see you. And, of course, it's Poppy's birthday today as well.
It is.
Yeah, so happy birthday, Poppy. Now, there's a very, very cool little fact you told me about foxes early on. Could you share it with the audience?
Yeah, different sorts of foxes have different attributes in different parts of the country. Artie here was brought to us from the northeast, the Wetland Centre
in
Washington.
So he's a Geordie fox?
He's a Geordie fox. And Geordie foxes have generally, not always, but generally have got longer legs than the ones on the northwest where we come from in Cumbria.
Fantastic. Well, I had no idea. I've learned something today. But thank you very much for bringing in your fantastic mammals. Lovely, lovely to see them. Now, we have got some rather lovely... Look at this. Look at this. Tea cozy. Look at this. This is... it's a regular feature. It's a regular feature. This is Lynn Hardman. Where's Lynn? Lynn! Thank you very much. You create these things regularly,
I do,
hear.
Yeah.
Martin's told me all about you. And this one is a fox. It's all in theme. Very, very wonderfully creative. But I did promise you a bit of an arty theme, a bit of created theme. And we have got, I want to invite to, I'm going to say to the sofa, but that's taken up, to the chest, Diane Beltram Herrera and Tom Paulson. Please come and join us. Thank you. Now, I've heard an awful lot about what you're about to show us.
Well,
I think you're going to put my egg to shame, aren't you?
I brought a little bit of one in poses, model in poses. And
oh, my goodness me.
The delicacy of
it. Oh, you've broken it already, Martin. Look, the wings come off. So
it's,
look
it's
at this.
In poses,
so this is made entirely of paper, is that right?
Yeah, it is made entirely of paper.
How on earth do you do that?
Well, I draw, I always look for photos in motion of these birds. And the first thing I do is draw a model on a computer. And then after that, I start to size, everything, legs and each feather and the wings. And after that, I start to create the skeleton in paper and start to paste each feather.
So this is the skeleton here that you've got. And this is a starling, obviously.
Yeah.
A very, very beautiful starling. Do you want to have a little look at that?
That is incredible.
Absolutely fantastic. Ooh. So what and how did you start doing this?
Well, as I come from Colombia, I've been always related with all kind of birds and nature. But what really made me feel concerned about them is that most of them were domestic, And then I started to put attention really in the partners that live in the wild, trying to see what they really function in the environment, you know, the movement, the action, and the motion. So that really caught my attention. And I wanted to represent them as a way to show them in a real life.
So this is all your birds are in action. They're all flying.
Yeah, they're all flying.
Wow! And you've done loads of different. Oh my goodness me! Look at that. You didn't choose an easy bird there, did you? With the bird, yeah. The bird of paradise. It's a blue jay. Look at that.
Is it blue jay or blue
jay? Blue jay. Yeah, blue jay.
Blue jay. Blue jay.
Fantastic. Absolutely amazing. And this is all made with paper.
All made with paper.
All made with paper. Fantastic. Now, as if one fantastic bird artist isn't enough, we have got two. So, Tom.
Yes.
You create models of birds out of plastic bricks.
Yes, I do. So you see them dotted around the studio.
Yeah, they're absolutely fantastic. Look at this. Which are your favourite ones?
The favourite is the robin there, because he was the start of it all. He was the inspiration behind the whole project. It was a moment when I was gardening and a robin landed on my fork handle, and that gave me the inspiration to actually start building birds.
That's quite a jump to suddenly go from seeing a robin to, you know, I'm going to build one out of Lego. So.
Oh yeah, well I've always been interested in the plastic bricks.
We've all been interested in the plastic bricks, haven't we? We've all got. Have you got any plastic bricks? I imagine you haven't.
No.
That's not really.
No.
Is it not?
No.
Shall we move on?
I have.
You've got some plastic bricks.
I have actually, because my son does them, and I had to build a Millennium Falcon recently. It took me 4.5 hours.
But you've probably done a real Falcon, though, haven't you? You've probably done
a
real Falcon.
No, I have not. It's in the pipeline.
It's a challenge for you.
Now, this is my favourite, if I may, and it's not a bird. It's a badger. Look at that one. Absolutely fantastic. And it's so accurate with its biological detail. Look, you can tell it's a male. It's got a wider tail. It's one of the ways of identifying the difference between a male and a female badger. Look, it's got a wider tail. And if you look very, very closely, it's got a subcaudal gland as well. Absolutely brilliant. I love that. Look at that. Oh, do that all day. All right, there we are. Brilliant. Thank you very, very much, guys, for coming in and sharing those gems with us. Big round of applause, please.
Yay!
Right. So we're now going to go for some man-made sculptures, from man-made sculptures to some natural ones. It's where we all get our inspiration from, after all. And we've been sent in these by Jeff Franklin. I've got the right one there. And look at that. He found these on his washing line. And that is the most beautiful thing. To an entomologist, someone who's into bugs, that is just... Oh, tessellation. Look at those tessellations. Now, those are eggs. We can do that. We've got a close-up there. You can see the patterns there. Now, the question is, we don't actually know what eggs they are. We've passed them all around the Autumn Watch team. Have you got any...
Moth. I think they're a moth egg. There's no doubt about that. But which moth? Each of those eggs... are sculpturally different. All the species are sculpturally different.
Yeah, yeah.
Someone out there who's been looking at moth eggs for the last 50 years in a shed every Sunday for 50 years with a microscope made of brass, bought at a boot sale in 1932, polished to perfection, would be able to watch.
They probably haven't got a TV set, though, and they probably aren't watching this. That's the problem. So, yeah, we've asked around the Autumn Watch office, and no one has come up with an answer. We've circulated this among various moth experts. The closest we've got is someone did think they might be the eggs of a large yellow underwing, but we don't really know.
Now they only said that because it's the commonest moth you get around laying eggs on washing lines.
I did wonder about that. Now, the thing I like about this, and it just brings forward another little thing that goes on nowadays, is with all this technology and with Autumn Watch and iSpot and everything, it's actually quite easy to just ask people to answer your questions for you. Back in the day, when Chris and I were little boys, we used to see something like that and we would rear them.
Exactly.
We would collect them, we'd cut your mother's washing line in sections and we would rear those and see what caterpillars hatched out, and we'd see the whole life cycle unfold, and then we'd see the adult moth. And that's how you answer questions, and that's how you get the answer.
That's the difference between the acquisition of knowledge and getting information.
Yes.
Oh, very
you
profound.
You are very right. Very profound.
I'll just eat the cake.
Right. Now, we have got another interesting bunch of photos here. These are sent in by Edward Chadfield. And it involves a pheasant. Well, I say a pheasant. This pheasant. Now, do you notice something going on there? No? Let's have a look at the next image. It's the same pheasant. Something weird is happening. Ooh. Now, this animal seems to be changing sex. Now, I know all about bilateral gynandromorphs, and this is not one of those. That's when you get a moth or butterfly split down the middle. Yeah. So we do not understand this. Now, I don't know anything about sex change. Martin, you do, though, don't you?
I do. Somebody thrust some notes into my hand just before the programme, and I didn't have time to read them, but I have a personal story, because my dad used to have pheasants, and we had a golden pheasant. It was a hen, and it laid eggs, and gradually, over a period of weeks, it began to change, and it turned into a resplendent golden pheasant cock, which became very, very aggressive and attacked us all. And I understand now that one in 500 birds has this...
You did read those notes.
Only that
You
bit.
Did read those notes.
No, that's just from my memory. But one in 500 birds is capable Precisely. Of changing sex. They do change.
Really?
They actually think that it may be damage to the ovaries that does it. But one in 500 does it. But then, of course, some fish do it.
Yeah, lots of mollusks.
But the difference is slip limpets and various wrasse do it. But that's, they go the other way, and also they're viable. Their babies are viable. With this animal's sterile. As a female, it's sterile, and the other males don't see this as a male. They see it as a female, so they don't respond to it in a territorial way.
It's confusing, wouldn't it?
Yeah, and look, she hasn't got all the wobbles and stuff like that.
No wobbles at all.
Brilliant, brilliant little thing. Anyway, we are sort of running out of time, which is rather sad. We're going to have to go to the quiz and find out how we've done with the quiz. Now, let's have a look at your... Pick up your birds. OK, right. Let's have a look at the map. OK, we've got this bird. Which bird is A? Which bird moves from Greenland to us on an annual basis? Comes down to this time of year. Which one would it be? Who got this one right, Joe?
The audience.
You know, a lot of people got them all right, I have to tell you.
Did they?
Shall we see?
They've been paying attention this week, haven't they?
They have. What have we got?
We've had Graham Powell, Deborah Wiltshire, Hannah Burgess, Keith White and Joe Blaze says, finally, I got the quiz right.
Yay! It was a very difficult week, though. We sent lots of really, very difficult quizzes and even I couldn't do any of them. So this is really good. This is the first one I've been able to do as well. So B is... Anyone in the audience know which of these birds is B? Waxwing. Waxwing.
They're all good, they know.
Remember, Chris's prediction is we won't get many this year? We'll find out in Winter Watch. We'll find out in Winter Watch if he's right. And this one here, who is leaving this country? It is Michaela. Michaela's Osprey. Brilliant. So there we are. That's our little quiz. So clarify the answer for you guys. We've got the geese there. Oh,
sorry.
The waxwing is B. And the osprey is C. Fantastic. So, Joe, do we have any last little comments from the audience? Anything of any interest there
Lots
at all?
Lots of people loving the cake, saying please get on and eat it.
I love the cake. Yeah, I know, it's really frustrating having all this cake floating around.
Ooh. And Jack Meehaw very quickly says, what do glowworms do in winter?
What do glowworms do in the winter? Good question. I believe they crawl under rocks as larvae, don't they?
They do. They overwinter as larvae under rocks. And the interesting thing is they move out of the grassland where they spend the summer and they go in underneath bushes so that when they wake up in the spring, they can access snails to eat them to get going.
That's right. And you can sometimes see them crawling about on paths in the spring.
Yep.
Anyway, this is pretty much it, guys. Mm. This is it. This is Autumn Watch is over.
Oh,
it's over. And it's really, really sad. I've had a great time. I'd like to thank all of the contributors, all the audience. Thanks so much. All the RSPB at Leighton Moss, because we have made a complete pain of ourselves while we've been here. the runners as well, in particular, especially Ben and Tim, who have basically been shuttling us backwards and forwards across the marsh. There's too many people to... The Red Button team, very important. The Red Button team have been fantastic.
Yeah, well done.
It's just too many people to thank, but thank you very much, guys, for inviting me into the family. It's been a lovely time, and we will see you all on Winter Watch.
Bye-bye.